Matt, you know what time it is?
You know what time it is?
You know what time it is?
Hello and welcome to This Is. We're going to take a look at some tech that's way older than you think and like try Matt. And guess where it's from.
Matt's wow. Older than you think.
Wow. Self-driving vehicles.
Okay, now see.
Sorry, Elon.
My guess is the first self-driving vehicle is going to be operated using like string and wind instruments.
They're like... A train count as self-driving. Does a horse and buggy count because it's...
Horse! Horses drive themselves! Look it up! It's in the dictionary! Oh, it's gonna be the thing. What's the emperor sit on? Where they like fan him and like feed him grapes? A pile or something? That's self-driving because he's just laying there and they're all like walking him. Why don't we take our best guess at this? And if we're wrong, we'll hope that the next slide puts us right.
I'm gonna be conservative with
this. Go ahead.
All right, and I'm gonna assume... Yep. Even though I know that I'm wrong.
Okay, great start.
That this is like a motor vehicle, like
sure.
A car.
I agree with that, yeah.
I'm going to say 1898.
So you know that the car was invented in like the late 1800s. It was like Carl Benz made it in like 1887 or some crap.
Yeah, 1898.
So he made it and it was immediately self-driving. Okay,
yeah.
Bold move. I'm going to go with 1979. For no particular reason other than I know that the late 70s, early 80s was when some digital stuff was starting to come up.
Not fully
self-driving. I understand.
I think I'm way off because I'm not old enough.
Boom!
1895!
That was pretty close.
Although self-steering techniques have likely been used since the invention of sailing, which is just wind. In 1895, a Canadian-American named Joshua Slocum fixed up a 37-foot-long sailboat optimized for self-steering in a variety of conditions for hours or even days on end.
He was able. But that's self-sailing. I would argue that that's an incorrect definition. Would you talk to a sailist and tell them that they're a driver on the seas? For record, this was 1895, so you're very close on the date. So I will say you're closest, but I have a feeling that there's more to this.
Woo! In 1939, GM created an exhibit in the 1939 World's Fair where they showed off a self-driving car that you could, in fact, actually ride in. It was electric and guided by radio-controlled electromagnetic fields. Science, bitch!
Clearly, 1939 was a great year for the world, and everything was wonderful and sunshines and dairy farms after that. And the world was filled with interconnected highways that were all radio controlled, and we lived happily ever after. Nothing bad happened after that point. Ooh! 1977, the Tsukuba Mechanical Engineering Lab designed the first automated street vehicle with environmental perception. Hey, Matt, you have the perception on this? It used two video cameras. Yes, you heard me right. This could reach speeds up to 20 miles an hour.
So if you're gonna show us three of them, I was closer to two of the three of them.
You said you were closest to a boat. You did not say a boat.
It was self-driving vehicle. Vehicle.
Are you a vehiclist?
At no point did we say car.
Are you a vehiclist?
Yeah. I'm going to vehicular manslaughter you in a second.
Oh!
Okay.
What year
okay.
were selfie cams invented?
I feel attacked right now. I actually think I know this dead on.
Is that some French dude? I bet some French dude. That's my first guess. French dude who likes to take portraits and then decided to turn the camera around and take a photo himself in 1872.
Okay.
He's French, though.
So you're wrong because he's Italian. It is the Shroud of Turin. You didn't go to church school like I did.
Shroud of
Turin.
Go ahead. No, I'm listening. Please tell me more about the Shroud of Turin.
In church school, they teach you of the Stations of the Cross. I actually don't think I'm pronouncing it right, the Shroud of Turin. There's a story of, like, someone gives him a cloth, and he wipes his face, and it's the face of Jesus, and it's an artifact. That's the story the church tells you. However, a lot of historians believe that shroud is actually Da Vinci.
What the what?
So it's a photo of him through a camera obscura onto a cloth.
Am I talking to ChatGPT right now? I feel like I'm
just
hearing random words right
now. I'm going to say in the 1200s. 1400s. 1500s.
Boy, that took a turn.
I think I'm right on this.
You said so many things, I don't even know how to argue with that.
Do you know what a camera obscura is? Do you know what a pinhole camera is?
I know what a pinhole camera is, yeah.
So a pinhole camera is a camera obscura. So because it's him, it's a selfie.
Sure.
It ain't an ussy. Ready?
No, please don't. Oh, good Lord, it's going to be on the video.
Yes, it sure is. Ussy! All right.
1839, Robert Cornelius produced a daguerreotype of himself, one of the very first photographs of a person. He looks kind of French, are you sure? It's Robert Cornelius.
I'm, I'm sorry, what?
The Minolta Disc 7 in 1983 took disc film. So this used a small convex mirror in the middle of the front plate, which could be used to, quote, compose a self-portrait. You could make the argument,
yep.
And I would not, because I think I already got this one, but you can make the argument that this is actually not the actual first selfie device, because you can take anything and put it on a stick if you try hard enough, but if you wanted to actually have a device that has a front-facing camera, if you want to strictly define a selfie camera as a device that you are going to take a selfie with that can turn around, it's going to be the Game Boy camera.
You're absolutely correct.
Yeah, let's go!
Oh!
Let's go!
No!
This is a beautiful device that I had in my ye little olden days when I was but a lad who wishes he was French, I guess. Boy, these things were dope. You could actually print them out on the Game Boy printer. And this was one of the world's first, not only digital cameras, but especially one of the ones that were commercial. But have you seen people who've like thrown like Canon lenses and stuff on these things?
Yes.
Like, it is incredible.
The 3D print amount. I'm going to make the argument that I was still right just because Kenzie didn't do her research.
What are you? Stop talking about Da Vinci.
Look, all right. So here is the Shroud of Turin. Here's what happened.
I'm going to say not that I would ever condone tomfoolery in this, but I think because Matt is so wrong and he's arguing so much, I maybe get two because I got the Game Boy camera and I got the French dude.
I'm
going to
throw you twice. And what part of it being French? The French was never a part of this. Bluetooth.
Okay, you go first because I think
some,
I know this
some,
one.
Get some speculative questions from you. Because are we talking Bluetooth or wireless?
No, I think it's got to be Bluetooth. This would be real bullshit if it says the word Bluetooth on the slide and we're meant to guess radio communication of some variety.
Having been humbled the last round, I'm going to just say 1979 for no reason other than it feels good.
Bluetooth was actually developed by Intel. So this was, I believe, in the late 90s. I'm going to just say like 1999. I don't know that for sure, but it was late 90s. Bluetooth actually wasn't meant to be the real name of it. That was just the code name. It was based on some like Norse god or something, and they couldn't come up with a better name, so they just shipped it as Bluetooth. I'm going to say 1999. I don't think I'm quite on
I'm
there.
Going I'm going 1979. I feel pretty confident about that for okay. No reason other than it feels good.
Harold is the Bluetooth 958. To 986 CE. I don't even know when that is. That's probably a long time ago. This was the King of Denmark, said to have united the tribes of Denmark and also assassinated his way into becoming the King of Norway for a few years. Pretty impressive. I haven't assassinated myself into a kingship lately, but the Bluetooth logo is a bind rune, aka a combination rune, Matt.
This is tech that we wish we'd come back. And while this is an awesome assassinating guy, I wouldn't call that tech. The first wireless headphones was in 1960s. Sounds a lot closer to me. Radio headphones that had AM, FM radio antennas and 2-inch speakers in each ear cup. Those are massive. That's basically like having like a big old
But I would just posit, not that I'm trying to, you know, take a W here or anything, but this is not Bluetooth, this is radio. And I could have taken in 1930, stuck a radio onto my head and called it a day. I would say, so we're talking about Bluetooth specifically.
Ericsson Company started developing in 1994, and they had a workable solution in 1997.
They decided to make this an open standard, which is where the Bluetooth Special Interest Group was formed in 1998, and the first Bluetooth specification was released in 1999. The first phone was in 2001. Look, I don't, I'm just gonna just get wiggly. Hang on, just one moment.
We gotta censor all of that now. 3D printing.
I don't like this photo, Kenzie. I don't like this photo. Oh, good Lord, Kyle's here. Clearly, my esteemed colleague, Kyle, is much more familiar. I'm just gonna say 1982.
Take the blinders off, man, all right?
Take them off, because you've been brainwashed your entire life, all right? Let's talk about the pyramids.
You think that they can move tons of bricks over those distances? No, absolutely not. Aliens, my friend. Aliens came down,
okay,
and they showed the people how to put brick by brick, but in little bits.
So they 3D printed the bricks?
They 3D printed the bricks by hand.
That's just making bricks. So if I punch you with my hand, am I 3D printing you?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
I'm telling you, the aliens showed us how to do 3D printing back in the year 2000 for the pyramids.
The year 2000?
BC. In the year 1224, Venetian glass beads. The Venetians had a near monopoly on glass bead trade for hundreds of years.
Classic.
However, they were spending way too much time building beads. So they came up with a technique called winding. And this method has been used since the ancient times, where they were mass producing them in Venice. Here's a fun fact. They got the idea from the same aliens from the year 2000 BC.
Wait, are you trying to say the alien bros were hanging out for like 800 years?
Yeah. Aliens, they're old, man. They just hang out. They just want to chill.
Yeah.
They want to vibe.
Have you met these? You seem like you have some personal experience.
Yeah, they give me the best drugs.
I'm sure someone does. With all due respect, Venetian glass beads might be stretching the definition. Is there maybe a...
Technology is whatever we make it, man.
He's doing it again. Is there another answer to this question that might be slightly more new than glass beads being 3D printed?
New or better answer?
1980s, actual 3D printing. 1971, Johannes Gottwald patented the liquid metal recorder, a device that used inkjet technology to form a, quote, removable metal fabrication, which, while never actually made, formed the conceptual basis for 3D
printing. Which never actually was made.
Checkmate, aliens. The first ever 3D printed part by Chuck Hull was 1983. Kenzie, would it be fair just to throw out here that I get a point for this one?
I would say so, because you were pretty spot on with the 80s.
Does Kyle get a point?
Kyle gets a point for pizzazz.
But Matt gets something?
Yes.
That checks out. I agree with that. Some might say that you could 3D print yourself a fully lifelike version of the subscribe button to press over and over again for your own viewing pleasure. However, I would posit it's a better idea to press the subscribe button on YouTube, specifically on the This Is channel, where you can get some high quality entertainment in featuring Matt, Austin, and your buddy Kyle directly to your subscription feed and or your notification tray if you're feeling extra ding-a-lingable.
I'm always feeling ding-a-lingable. Like, follow, subscribe. We'll catch you in the next one. Let us know what tech was older than we thought.
And that Austin was right about most of them.
What?